for coming tonight. I'm Gwyneth Mallon. I'm the director of the NYU Center for the Humanities, and I'm very pleased to welcome you all here this evening. I want to thank our staff, first and foremost, Denny Valentin, Caroline Osi, and our students, Janina Soriano and Soraya Buckner, for their help with tonight's event. This event is part of our Digital Humanities series. Every semester throughout the series, we sponsor several evenings of conversations centered around cutting-edge scholarship and knowledge creation in the digital humanities. Tonight, we're here to have a talk and to have an interaction and intervention around inscription, digitization, and the shape of knowledge. And the cornerstone of tonight's panel will be our opportunity to learn from Dr. Lauren Kassell about her project to digitize one of the largest surviving sets of medical records in history. As you saw on our flyer, it's 80,000, correct? Okay. Consultations recorded by 17th century astrologer and physicians Simon Forman and Richard Napier. Now, to any of us who have processed or worked with digitizing collections, the scale of this collection is quite staggering, and we're very fortunate to have Professor Kassell here with us this evening. She's given postcards to each of you on your chair, so you can see how the project is being described. And three NYU scholars are going to join us as respondents. Marion Fain will be moderating. And I'm just going to briefly introduce everyone and then turn the evening over to Marion. The format will be Lauren will give her talk first. Marion will serve as moderator, and then there'll be a response from each of the three respondents, and then hopefully some conversation, and then, of course, time for questions from the audience. Lauren Kassell is reader in history of science and medicine in the Department of History and Philosophy of Science at the University of Cambridge and fellow of Pembroke College. All of her work considers the material evidence for what we know about the past, mostly through studies of magic and medicine in early modern England. I meant to say I'm going to really abbreviate these bios. I got approval from all participants that that's okay, so I'm just going to do two sentences per person, just to give us plenty of time so you actually get to hear from them live and in person. If you want the printed bios, we can get those to you at another time. Cliff Siskin is the Henry W. and Alfred A. Berg Professor of English and American Literature at New York University and the director of the Re-Enlightenment Project. His subject is the interrelations of literary, social, and technological change, with a particular emphasis on print culture, both its historical formation and its current remediation in the face of electronic and the digital. Lisa Gitelman is a media historian whose research concerns American book history, techniques of inscription, and the new media of yesterday and today. She is particularly concerned with tracing the patterns according to which new media become meaningful within and against the context of other media, older media. Matthew Hockenberry is a media historian and technologist whose work examines critical developments in the epistemology of assembly to speak to the conditions of the world apparatus of production. As a visiting scientist at MIT Center for Civic Media and Tangible Media Group, he developed SourceMap, a collaborative platform for mapping supply chains and sharing where things come from. And Marion Fain teaches literature and the liberal arts at New York University, and she's also associate director of the digital humanities at the Faculty of Arts and Science. Her research is primarily in the areas of aestheticism and decadence, British poetry and poetics, and the digital humanities. So without further ado, I'm going to have Lauren start her talk, and then we'll hear from Marion and the respondents. Thank you.
Thank you all for making this event happen. I'll keep all these thank yous brief, but I do need to say that Chris Cannon was the force behind it, and I'm very, very grateful to him for then what seems to have been an extremely good idea, and I'm very grateful in advance to the respondents for the nice things and constructive things and probing things they're going to say. So, there's a big title for this event. It's clearly drawn a lot of you in. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about what I know about inscription, digitization, and the shape of knowledge from my work on the Casebooks project. So what is the Casebooks project is where we need to begin. It is a digital edition of one of the most extensive surviving sets of medical records in history, as you've already heard. These records fill 30,000 pages, now bound in 64 volumes. I was just sent this slide today. It's a mock-up of the spines. They couldn't film them all together in a row, so I got individual photographs of the spines and somebody put them together for a different purpose, but I couldn't not share it with you. That in the 17th century was a lot. That's 64 volumes, 30,000 pages. When we think of a lot of books, we don't think of something that looks just like that. This is all held, they're all held in the Ashmole collection in the Bodleian Library, Oxford, and they were written by Simon Forman and his protege, Richard Napier. Forman was a notorious astrologer in London. Richard Napier worked as a clergyman in Buckinghamshire, which is now in a little village, which is now part of Milton Keynes. For those of you who know your British geography, it's a little weird. So they were at work. Their records survive from 1596 to 1634. That's a very long, almost 40-year run. So the project has been, the project is innovative in its approach to digital editing and in its engagement framework. At the same time, it builds on conventional scholarship and it plays with the relationship between paper technologies and digital technologies. So what I'm going to do is introduce the project and draw attention to some of the questions that the project, for me, has raised about inscription, digitization, and the shape of knowledge. As I put together these notes, I tried to number the questions, and I'll take you through all of them all together at the end, but I'll stumble across them as we go. There are seven. The first one is, what does it mean to create a new archive out of an old archive? That's what this project does. And I should say at the outset that I am a historian of science and medicine. I have always worked on material records. I love the archive, but I found myself inadvertently in the field of digital humanities. I did not set out to run a huge project. That was never the plan. So that having not been the plan, this is my sort of bragging slide, which is also a cautionary slide. I have secured over the last decade £2 million to run this project. And the reason it's a cautionary slide is that with everything digital, digital is expensive, and we need to ask whether it's worth it. And at every juncture, I ask whether it's worth it, and I also think it's really important that we say how much these things cost, because if you're going to compare my project to a project that costs £10,000 or $10,000, you need to know what the resources behind it have been. Your expectations for this project should be very high. All of that money, bar about £350,000, all the rest of it has paid these people. None of it has paid for any of my time. All of it has paid for them, and without them, they're camera shy. Usually this would be us in front of the building smiling. These are the people who make this project possible. I won't talk more about that. We can talk about it in the discussion if you like, but I really want to get into what we do, not the mechanics of the career prospects of and the finances of digital humanities projects, which are very, very real issues for me and my researchers. So what are these casebooks? This is a page of Richard Napier's casebooks. It's also, this is the same image that you have on the postcard. Here is the same page anatomized. And I quickly want to take you through what you're seeing here. So the full page is the thumbnail on the left. A single case is inset on the right. The case is best understood as containing four major classes of information. We've imposed this on it. They're indicated by the letters on the far right. A is the question and personal information about the patient. B is the chart of the heavens at the moment that the question was asked. C is the astrologer's judgment of the case. D is extra information. So category A reads, Elizabeth Hartwell of Astwood, once Mrs. Uvedale's servant, 25 years unmarried, hath clumpers of blood in her mouth, 15th September, the symbol Saturn for the day Saturday, hour 1:15 p.m., 1599. What that means, in terms of how we classify it, is that the patient is Elizabeth Hartwell. Her address is Aswood, that's a village 10 miles from Napier's house. She was formerly a servant in Mrs. Uvedale's, a servant to Mrs. Uvedale, so that's a social relationship. She's 25 years old. That's her, obviously her age. She suffered from blood clots in her mouth. Those are the clumpers of blood. And that is the question topic, which in this case is repeated. I'm not going to move because I'm chained to the mic, but it's repeated in the middle of the chart. There's an added note which says clumpers of blood. And her question was asked, obviously, the date and time on Saturday, the 15th of September, 1599 at 1:15 p.m. So underneath her question, we have what we call category B information, which is the astrological chart, what you might think of as a horoscope. It's calculated for the moment at which the question is asked. The casebooks are organized chronologically. It is the only order in the 64-volume run. Below that, we have category C, where the astrologers write their judgment. And here we learn that Elizabeth Hartwell has been in bed for a week with a fever. It's caused by the malign influence of Mars. Those around her suspect that it's a pleurisy, it's a problem with her lungs or a pain in her chest, or an impulse, a swelling, and they fear that she will die. At the end of the entry, we have category D information, which is where we find out that Napier prescribed three sorts of purges and a cooling tincture, and he waived the fee. It says gratis down at the bottom, very small. That is clearly the treatment and fee and payment information. So Forman's and Napier's records contain 80,000, as you've heard, cases like this one. The project, the casebooks project, sets out to allow readers to make sense of any given case and to understand the series as a whole. I'll say a little bit more about what that simple phrase, make sense of, and understand mean in a second. Now, I want to digress for a second. Why did Forman and Napier write these records? Why did doctors write things down? What is a casebook? What is the history of writing practices? That's my second question that I may have been a bit slow, but as we've worked on this project, we've obviously had to say, hang on a minute, why are these guys writing this stuff down and other guys are writing some things down? Well, why is anybody writing things down at this point? As historians in science and medicine, we take it, the starting point is that you have to ask questions about bodies, about emotions, about diseases. None of it is taken for granted. So what is the history of writing practices becomes what there is no obvious answer to it. So I have set about trying to answer it. A casebook is a written collection of cases, typically recorded in a series day by day. Doctors developed this form of writing in Europe in the 1500s. They had borrowed scholarly practices of note-taking and mercantile habits of account-keeping. They modeled themselves on Hippocrates, the ancient father of medicine, who had reputedly recorded case histories on clay tablets. And by writing case books, these doctors were participating in an increased interest in natural particulars. They built on the works of ancient and medieval physicians whose writings detailed remarkable cases and exceptional cures. Note-taking followed conventions. You learned this art. But the habits of talking about things, of writing about things, and collecting things that produced these documents were very idiosyncratic. So the surviving casebooks take a variety of forms. Some are like account books written at the time of the encounter. Here we see a practitioner at work in his study with a woman visiting him. We can interrogate the image later if you want. He's not actually writing in it. Others, like journals or diaries, were written when a doctor returned to a study after a day visiting patients. So here's the full image of Jean Fernel, very famous 16th century French physician. That is the larger image. This is, obviously there's no patient there, there is a skeleton standing next to him. And here we have the detail which I held the place with a minute ago. These doctors, whether they wrote them on the spot during the consultation or at the end of the day, some of them digested their accounts in or diaries, whichever they were, into what we call observations at a later stage. So we have this progression. And they narrated histories of the diseases and of the cure, and then they might discard the rougher notes. So whatever form the case books took, they typically included the patient's name, the age, the complaint, its causes, and a prescription and payment, as we saw in the instance in Forman's, or in Napier's case book that I was showing you a second ago. So around, we think, well, so far we've identified, not me, I've identified the English ones, and other scholars have identified case books around Europe, and we have examples of about 100 surviving up to the period, up to 1700, about the records of around 100 practitioners. They vary in size and scale. They're often cataloged as account books, diaries, journals, practice books, collections of cures or observations, or case books. And the term case book was initially used for legal records in the late 17th century and then applied to doctor's notes in the mid 18th century. So I use the word case book to refer to the range of records that medical practitioners produced when they recorded their practices. I use the word case book as a collective word to talk about all of these residues of practice that I've just been describing, but it is a category imposed from a later date. It may not be wise for me to do that, but that is where we are. When I started working on Forman and Napier's casebooks, they were called casebooks, and I didn't stop to think, oh, maybe we should call them something different. Practice journal isn't a very appealing phrase. It is what some other scholars wish to call these things. So casebooks, like other new forms of written documents, were the product of what has been labeled by some scholars the first age of information overload. So with the shift from expensive parchment to affordable paper and from laborious Gothic to fluid cursive scripts, people wrote more. They developed habits of recording financial, civic, and personal accounts and new tools to order, navigate, and preserve the resulting messes of paper. So doctors adopted these new paper technologies to account for and reflect on their studies and study their practices in the consulting room. So we have Forman's and Napier's casebooks are the most extensive surviving set of medical records for this period. That's what that survey establishes. So if we now return to the casebooks, everything I've said has been about the form, right? I haven't talked about the content, and I realized as I zoomed in on this, this figure of course shows you all form and no content. You can't see anything about what he is in fact writing, and I think it's probably not medical, but it is a medical image. So here is our, in terms of the content, here is the casebooks project's entry for the consultation about Elizabeth Hartwell that I was talking to you about a second ago. We designate each case with a unique number. This case is case 12702. We transcribe the text above the chart, that's the category A information in the anatomized page, and we systematically label the attributes of the full case in everything in A to D with metadata. We cannot transcribe and code the full record, at least not at this stage, because we simply do not have time. So we chose the case of Elizabeth Hartwell, this sole case, because it illustrates 11 of the 49 labels that might be attached to a case of this sort. And most don't even have 11 different kinds. So we wanted one that was as illustrative as possible. Our metadata is not simply about the documents. it's about their content. I don't expect you to be able to read this, but this is the code for that single case. And so there's a lot of code on that for those of you who don't know it. So my third question is, are we editing, it has come up as we've worked on the project, are we editing what the astrologers wrote or the encounter that their records document? And this is an old editorial dichotomy, which I don't want to say a lot more now, but I want to put that question out there. And part of the answer is that what the digital edition enables us to do is both, and we can do that through the layers of coding. So what the metadata does is it allows us to search and to sort the vast expanse of these records. This is currently done through a search form where readers can search for all people with a specific name, all cases on particular days, and so forth. They can find out that a huge amount of, it's 90% of the cases are medical. They get these summary slides with visualizations and actually sentences and data help people to see what's going on. So the fourth and fifth questions are, how do we help readers navigate this expanse of material? Because what we have found is that nobody wants to use the search forms. They're not helpful. Don't use search forms if you don't have to use search forms. And the second issue is the fancier we make things, the more the site will degrade. Websites have a 7-year lifespan. We don't have infinite time and money. So there's always this check on the project. We want it to be as functional and intuitive as possible, and it will degrade, the front end of it will degrade. So those two additional questions become how do you make it readable, and how do you preserve it? And one of the answers is that you move it to a library, and I'm not going to say more about that right now, but that is one of the things that we are doing. You have an archive, you put it in a library. It now makes perfect sense. At the outset of the project, nobody could work that out. So we have also, what we do with the insides of the material is we establish taxonomies. We have a whole series of topics, again, which I'm not going to take you through in any great detail. We have person pages so that you can find any person, any case shows you any person mentioned in one case, you can find out if they feature in any other cases. You can situate any given person in demographic terms. You can situate that person socially, and we hope in due course to give our data to another project so that they can, this is a homemade slide, situate the people geographically, because outsourcing is another thing that we have learned while doing this project. So what are our outputs? This is the ugliest slide I've ever made. I'm sorry for showing it to you. This project has two sorts of outputs, and that is one of the things to remember. The degrading bit, the front end, is the website, which contains the search interface plus around 100,000 words of explanatory texts and some other things too. And the second thing we're producing, which is much more robust, and what is the thing we are actually most proud of, is a massive data set, which will have 3.5 million words of edited text, plus six times that much meaningful metadata when it's complete. So that is all on GitHub, and openly accessible to anybody who wants it now. It's just we haven't done all the work yet. So the sixth question is, one of the things by putting all of this stuff out there now that we have discovered is that people don't read. They certainly don't read stuff that you put out to them on their computers. And so our question is, how do we make our editorial work represent the text to readers so that they are drawn in, so that they know what they are reading, and so that they can read it? So our ambition is to allow readers to see all 80,000 cases recorded by Forman and Napier, and to zoom in on particular details in the archive. And I'm going to finish in 1 minute. So digitization makes all of this possible. But one of the things that it's important for me to say is that we put all of this up on the web, and there's a lot of outward-facing activity, but this is not a public engagement project. This is not an outreach project. It is not about drawing people into the records, getting schools to work with them, and explaining 17th century medicine. If that happens, that is a bonus. This is about making sense of these archives at the highest possible level so that everybody can understand them at the highest possible level. And again, we might want to think about that. So part of what has happened, and this is my seventh and final point, is that the challenge for us is we're discovering is that when we present what looks like data, people think it's data. And it's not statistically significant. It's heavily inscribed within these records, and our coding is true to those records. And so what we need to do is find a way to help readers to identify the bundles of material that they want to use for intensive study, and to better grasp the subtleties of the inscriptions in the records. The danger of presenting it as data is that it flattens it, and that we end up eliding the dynamic that produced the records, and silencing the language that includes the subtlety. So one answer to that would be free text search. We do not have free text search on the site, and that is because nothing is standardized in its spelling. So we would have to standardize all spelling and the phrases that go with it in order for people to be able to do that. And that would be a whole nother project in itself. So I should stop there, but what I want to conclude with, I had some other things to conclude with, but I am over time, is that one of the things we've discovered as our answer to not flattening things is that we, for our own purposes, have fallen back on a handmade index, which doesn't claim to be comprehensive, and which is an absolute riot to read, and which allows you to find things that you would be able to find with a free text search, but which also allows you to see that there are these themes that emerge across, so I gave you the W's because it has writing at the end of it, that emerge across the records if you are able to follow these threads. And that is the kind of thing that when we move to the library, a faceted interface will allow us to prompt our readers into these directions. But it's actually an old technology that has required us to, that enables us to see what it is that we are doing with this new technology. So I will end there. I have a handy list of my seven questions, but I won't spend time reading them now, but we can go back to them if anybody needs us to. Okay, thank you.
So thank you very much to Lauren for that really thought-provoking introduction. I'm going to pass over now to our three respondents who are each going to comments hopefully in various different ways. I don't know, we haven't rehearsed this. We'll see what happens. On the kinds of issues that Lauren has just raised and from their own experience of engaging with the project. Cliff, I think, is going first. And each of our three responses is going to take about 10 minutes.
Well, I appreciate the big invitation. I should clarify, I am not an expert in medical history. I've been in regard to addiction in the 19th century. And so my focus is on the question that was on the poster, which has to do with the issue of how might the digitization of archival information change the shape of knowledge. I'm going to go in a number of different directions, but I've timed this, so it'll be over in a minute. First, let me say without any hesitation that Lauren has created the best digital archive experience that I have ever. But I do have a request for one addition to the website. It arose from a recent medical experience of my own. After weeks of sniffling and stuffiness this past fall, I went to my doctor, who sent me for tests, and then summoned me to his office to announce that I had, quote, New York nose. I would love, Lauren, to add just one more feature to your project, the ability to query the website, have a chart thrown, and get a second opinion that might just be more helpful than the first. Adding that facility would certainly increase traffic to the website. Just one viral outbreak and Casebooks might go viral. I'll forgo optimization fantasies tonight, however, in favor of the speculative mode of this event's central query. How might the digitization of archival information change the shape of knowledge? Let me first detangle what I see as two basic impulses here. The first is a desire to make a complete archive widely available. The second is to use digital technology to accomplish that. Separating the two can help us zero in on the digital factor. My example of the complete accessible archive had its origins in the nuclear fears of the Cold War, when a Wordsworthian at Dove Cottage sought to preserve the Romantic poet's manuscripts by microfilming them. A copy was given to Cornell University, which already held the best collection of printed William Wordsworth materials. By the mid-1960s, one of the most monumental archiving projects of the era of print was launched. The Cornell Wordsworth produced 21 volumes over 32 years, from 1975 to 2007. Each massive volume containing reading texts, transcriptions of underlying manuscripts, photographs of those manuscripts, a full record of all printed variants up to the final lifetime edition, and commentary. For those digital archivists who worry about failing hard drives and incompatible systems, it may be comforting to hear the perils of print. One manuscript was hijacked from a truck, and another fell onto an airport tarmac and was flattened and scattered by an oncoming vehicle. The problems most relevant to this evening, however, occurred after publication. Within a few years after the release of the initial volumes, a number of them started showing up in remainders catalogs. While a primary teaching text for Wordsworth courses, the only complete edition of the poems as published went out of print and has stayed that way. Interest in Wordsworth, which had peaked in the 50s and 60s, had a small bump in the first year of the first volume, 1975, but then plummeted to a 50-year low by 2000. And much of what is still done does not focus or depend on manuscript and revision issues. I see two paradoxes emerging from this print venture to help us address what the digital archive might do. What I call the paradox of access is the puzzle of why the effort to make the archive more widely available to more people might not only not work, but even backfire, attracting specialists, but also heightening the sense that the subject of the archive is a specialized subject. The stakes here are much higher for a digital venture, where free internet access instead of expensive printed volumes raises the prospect of attracting that newly enticing entity, the public. I'm surprised by Lauren's statement about the public. I wrote, Lauren is clearly aware of how many digitization projects have not delivered on that promise of an expanded audience to their funders, since she has mounted an outreach program that, like the whole site, is best in class, from titling the site Magic and Medicine, to museum exhibitions, video games, public debates, planting clues in the Guardian crossword puzzle, postcards. But whether these efforts resolve the paradox of access will turn, I think, on a second paradox, the paradox of more. More Wordsworth did not produce more Wordsworth. In addition to knowledge, more might make it harder to produce more and even lessen the desire to do so. The excitement of producing knowledge in the humanities and consuming it has its roots in scarcity, in the challenge of assembling scattered parts into possible wholes, of the archaeological romance of finding fragments and conjecturing connections. We interact by comparing conjectures, revising, rejecting, and replacing with tools that crucially were and are designed for the kind of work that an incomplete archive requires. Our knowledge has been shaped by those tools. A complete archive, one that tries to fill the gaps, would require new tools. That's where the reshaping of knowledge will begin. The old tools were forged in the technological environment of print, a physical environment of relative information scarcity compared to the digital present and the virtual future. Close reading is one of the most familiar examples of these tools of scarcity. From the moment that Wordsworth told the readers of lyrical ballads to read his poems in the same, quote, style that he wrote them, quote, looking steadily, we have moved in closer to the text in order to make more out of it. The further we burrow in, isolating each word, each image, the more we have to say. Canonization, the vector of less, and close reading, the vector of more, are the paradoxical counter movements of the modern literary system. Ideology, whatever the politics of the hands that grip it, has until recently served that same system well, for that tool shares with close reading origin, purpose, and function. It first surfaced in Britain in 1797, the very year Wordsworth began to look steadily. The purpose of that gaze was to keep the reader, quote, in the company of flesh and blood, a commitment to the material reality of the physical, matched by ideology's launch as the, quote, science of grounding ideas in physical sensation. Their shared function was to make knowledge follow the logic of the physical, to grow by making more of itself, to flesh out the real by adding more layers, whether of interpretations or of consciousness. Close reading developed hand in hand with what I call the practice of close writing. I was in my fourth colloquium at three different universities on the fate of close reading before I realized that something crucial was missing from the discussion. The reason that we read closely is that we can then write closely, that is, write more about less. Historically, the practice of close writing produced the standard forms of modern humanistic analysis, including that strange phenomenon of entire books, hundreds of pages long, on a single author or a few texts. The problem of thinking of our current age as an age of information overload is that it turns the past into the age of just the right amount, a strange notion indeed, rather than the age in which we can now see that relative scarcity was leveraged by our economy of reading and writing into more. Only right now, with digitization projects at the scale of Casebooks, might we gain a new sense of what more can actually be. Whether we experience that more as itself a debilitating overload or as an opportunity to reshape knowledge will depend on our willingness to push the tools of scarcity to the bottom of the toolbox, making room for those that manage more. What if, instead of having to make more out of something, we could find a pattern in it or place it into a larger pattern? Pattern recognition, a survival technique developed in a number of disciplines, can take the form in digital and thus computable archives, rather than the dispersed print of the Cornell Wordsworth, of conceptual algorithms, repeatable discrete templates, both for solving particular problems and for providing cumulatively alternative modes of attention. Scalability and emergence, to take two examples, focus our attention not just inward to individual objects, like close reading, but on chaotic relationships between quantitative and qualitative change. Do the same structures and functions repeat themselves across scales from micro to macro, or do new phenomena unexpectedly emerge? The point is not what you and I want, closeness or complexity, but what all analytic tools are. They are data sensitive, and thus in important ways, they are specific to particular moments in the history of mediation.
As my wife, Leslie Siskin, who is a sociologist of education, trained in pattern recognition analysis of schools and schooling, pointed out to me, pattern recognition without enough data is metaphysics. The tools of scarcity with too much data are, I am arguing, the same thing. Casebooks is the more we've been waiting for. With its size, aggressive metadata, and strategic outreach, it signals that right now we have enough to change, to take the trouble to reorganize and restock our toolbox. We have nothing to lose but metaphysics, and think of what we might gain. Thanks.
So we can talk about something somewhat different or from a different perspective. So the Casebooks project, although primarily concerned with a body of work first begun at the end of the 16th century, has, I think, a particular salience to a significant portion of the intellectual activity being undertaken today. In my own work in production, I've been drawn to the idea of assembling productive networks, supply chains, as a particular kind of object for professional diagnosis. And the form that this work often takes, it may not surprise you, is the case. So not only are the casebooks Kassell presents set in a compelling instantiation of that particular model of technical work that I think has increasingly come to define the forefront of contemporary research, but is one that is made all the more compelling through the unique materials it places in that frame, the largest collection of the forms of these cases that had begun to appear in Europe in the early modern era. By assembling these accounts, which Kassell reminds us are not necessarily to be taken as cases, but these accounts recorded by Forman and Napier in the first decades of the 17th century for our investigation, Kassell not only engages in the preservation of some historic product of the past, I think she reminds us that the case is indeed a fascinating form for the future. Those of us gathered here tonight might recognize this saccadic temporality in our own work. The idea of the case is, after all, something that binds the study of medicine to the study of the humanities. What is our work if not the study of the postmortem, the M&M, the careful and concerned accounting of what has gone wrong, how it could be set right, if not now, then at least next time? Indeed, Kassell's astrologers have proven strikingly prescient, although not necessarily in the way they might have imagined. Just as the stars they figured as the means for future prediction were, themselves, messages from a distant past, so too has the form of the case continued to project far beyond its originary circumstances. Looking through the digitized pages of the casebooks, I couldn't help but consider the comparatively ancient accounts recorded by Forman and Napier in the context of the rather more recent accounts from the medical profession. In particular, I turned to the posts presented for examination on the contemporary web application Figure 1, the so-called Instagram for doctors, which encourages medical practitioners throughout the world to share their most interesting or problematic cases, along with the high-resolution imagery which will help illustrate them. To offer you just one example, I'd like to read a post from Dr. C, a self-identified specialist in emergency medicine. He writes of a 45-year-old male who came to the ER with a history of 6 days of evolution with fever, pleuritic chest pain, shortness of breath, and cough. The patient, the case records, was admitted to the ICU and was treated with hashtag meropenem, hashtag zithromycin, and hashtag linezolid. Pictures 1 and 2 of an x-ray from the ER and pictures 3, 4, and 5 of an x-ray and chest CT recorded the day after suggest bilateral hashtag pneumonia with right hashtag pleural effusion. This is, Figure 1 specifically states, a case. But it is, I think, fair to say, not entirely like the sort that have been brought to us in the pages of the Casebook Project. And part of this dissimilarity simply stems from the fact that hundreds of years of ongoing systemization has codified and corrected the terminology we have come to associate with the proper practice of medicine. Casual descriptions of physical phenomena like clumpers of blood in the mouth have been simplified by more appropriately scientific jargon and acronyms. Archaic terms like impostume have been substituted for more modern equivalents like abscesses. Treatments rested on the conditional and complex recipes for purges and tinctures have been replaced by hashtag mandates for the prescription of meticulously manufactured drugs. Figure 1's cases, it would seem, present with far more of the symptoms increasingly endemic to the practice of writing contemporary accounts. Details have been replaced by data, lists replaced by links, recollections replaced by reports. The descriptive identity of a woman like the 25-year-old Elizabeth Hartwell of Astwood is replaced with the otherwise anonymous record of a 45-year-old male. This comparison is not intended to suggest that the cases that Forman and Napier prepared were themselves entirely archaic, or indeed absent any sort of precision. The astrologers, the Casebook Project reminds us, practiced their profession with, quote, pen in hand, carefully recording the precise moment their question had been asked so as to construct the astrological chart that would answer it. Only by plotting the positions of the five known planets, the sun and the moon, within the 12 celestial houses could the astrologers judge the influence of celestial bodies on the comparatively more fragile human ones under consideration. But the case of Elizabeth Hartwell is not only more verbose than the comparable account found in Figure 1, but in recording the question given on the precise date of 15th of September, 1599 at 1:15, it appears significantly more precise. Figure 1's case, even with its reliance on digital diagrams, is nevertheless absent even the most approximate timestamp. The Casebooks project asks us to imagine the cases it collects as otherwise, quote, alien objects. But in some respects, there is something more familiar here than might otherwise be imagined. It leads, quite naturally, I think, to the question of what, after all, has changed. Both sets of cases are strange hybrid forms, melanges of action and accountability, composed with the constitution of qualitative and quantitative data. In a certain kind of light, the cases seem to have simply exchanged the concordance of the positions of the planets for those of charts mapping out tests, panels, and counts. Are contemporary practitioners, the question is, offering up only a competing, although hopefully more effective, numerology, more familiar to us only through its familiar form? The case, Kassell reminds us, is tied to the history of accounting. In this way, it is tied to the formation of objective knowledge, to the references to numeric accountability and precise classification. It is this form that lends it the appearance of an object somehow immune from theory and interpretation. And this is as true of Forman and Napier's cases with their star charts, just as it is Figure 1's cases with their CT scans and X-rays. And I don't say this to suggest that we necessarily believe in the efficacy of star charts, or that it would be wise to advocate for their use diagnosing the problems of patients in the contemporary moment. Indeed, I think it's fair that we might be reasonably skeptical about the claim that Hartwell's fever was caused by the malign influence of Mars. But we nevertheless believe in the facts of the case, that Hartwell had a fever, swelling, and pain in her chest. Just the same as we believe in the facts presented concerning the comparatively more recent 45-year-old man suffering with fever, chest pain, and shortness of breath. We may no longer ascribe these particular references the same meaning that Forman and Napier would have, but we still believe there is something here that resembles the world, and more importantly, that the form of the case represents a valuable means for circulating it. The examination, Foucault wrote, surrounded by all its documentary techniques, makes each individual a case which at one and the same time constitutes an object for a branch of knowledge and a hold for a branch of power. It is not necessarily the examination, I would suggest, but the writing down of it. In bringing the case into the making of modernity, we have brought with it the construction of a particular model for knowledge, one premised, as Foucault explains, on the construction of the individual. An individual who may be described, judged, measured, and compared so that they can be trained, corrected, classified, normalized, and excluded. Is the introduction of the individual as the primary site of, at the very least, a medical investigation and the beginning of a trajectory that will come to prize this singular site over broader conditions of culture, community, and climate? One must wonder if there is something notable in the fact that the astrologers turn to the heavens for their answers. In that gesture, they seem to seek for an answer outside of the very site their cases would now construct, both prefiguring the question of cause and casting doubt on the certainty of their site. Cases possess a potential for power that comes with their constitution. Galen wrote that the Hippocratic epidemics were not treatises nor works meant to be divulged among the Greeks, but rather hypomemata, notes, which Foucault explains as constituting a material memory of things read, heard, or thought, offering accumulated treasure for rereading and later meditation. It is this as yet raw predictive potentiality that gives cases their power. Just as the epidemics were sought in the setting of rules for diagnosis and treatment in the ancient world, and just as the cases Kassell collects for us represent a form that has been spread throughout the foundations of the modern world. The case is a call for consultation. For Forman and Napier, the answers might well be found in the heavens, but for the posters at Figure 1, the answers are found in the cloud. They're found in the reminder from user Troy Nurse Practitioner, no spaces, that they should rule out empemium by tapping the effusion and sending for the pH of the fluid, cell count, LDH, and other assorted indexes, or the questions asked by Krieg Medical Student, no spaces, about what exactly necessitated the various drugs that had been prescribed. The case is the constitution of a question that must inevitably be answered, if not by the stars, then by something else. In the formulation of the case comes the power of demand for analysis and investigation, the extension of old rules and the formulation of new ones. The study of technology, design, in my own work of production, finds cases in the acts of invention and manufacture, the disasters described in human factors analysis, the catastrophic impacts brought by the failures of supply chains. To see the study of the supply chain as the study of the collection of particular cases is to privilege them as a particular object of knowledge, with a particular hold for power. To see them as cases, for me, of environmental degradation, human rights abuse, local or global production. By constituting something as a case, each new inscription brings to the figure of the future a particular prediction from the past.
Thanks, everybody. I want to thank the Humanities Initiative, Lauren, of course, and Chris for helping to put this up. Center for the Humanities. I'm still, you know, a year behind the times. My remarks are probably going to be shorter and a lot less formal, but I think that they do have a lot in keeping with Cliff's points about the paradox of access, the paradox of more, the power of scarcity, as well as Matt's calling our attention to the case as a kind of instance, if you like, or a kind of site and segment of knowledge formation with the emphasis there on the form that has an incredible efficacy, if you like. I'm on leave these days, so I'm going to say maybe a couple things about something I'm hoping to write, and then just reminisce a little about my introduction to the digital humanities, in a sense, on a different editing project. And I think the hero of the story in both cases will be the Casebook projects, even if I don't make that terribly explicit. Just a kind of current interest of mine, very much a hobby horse, again, thinking of the richness here, but also its legs as a provocation. If you are in American letters, you know that the author Mark Twain blamed the American Civil War on the novels of Sir Walter Scott. According to Twain, it was Scott's novels, the Waverly novels in particular, that sort of seduced Southern grandees and granddames and white wannabes into a kind of feudal interest, feudal nobility, if you like, and their lost cause. So knowing this, I've been wondering a lot lately who we should blame for the current red state, blue state agon, if you like, of today. What I want to write, I think, is an essay that blames Wikipedia, which might come as a surprise. I have to say, I love Wikipedia. I contribute to Wikipedia. I think historians who, you know, harumphed 10 years ago about never letting students look at Wikipedia were wrong. But I think that Wikipedia's prohibition against original research is something that we need to take a serious look at. Closely related to this is its hesitation about primary sources, in particular because primary sources are thought by Wikipedians to be too much of a temptation to original research. Original research on Wikipedia is closely tied with the kind of virtue of, or it's the vice closely tied to the virtue of neutral point of view. It seems to me that there must be a way in which this, or the kind of massive uptake of this paradigm, this kind of fact-based, secondary source-related, non-original research, has provided the groundwork for alternative facts and fake news. So I want to kind of try and step that in that direction. But as I said, I think the hero of the story here is really not anything that I can put together, but rather primary sources. And the kind of documentary sensibility that the digital humanities now is our sort of most powerful source for. I think what we need is we need to figure out ways to broadly promote evidentiary practices as something, and I think this is where Wikipedia is so scared. They don't see evidence as self-evident in any way. So scarce evidence, evidentiary practices that are necessarily social, right, and therefore kind of professional or selective, produced by various groups for certain normative reasons. I think all of these things are the kind of countervailing, so the place we have to go to counteract what has become a kind of dominant paradigm describing the facts so that we can have alternative facts. Anyway, I hope that's a little elusive there. Let me get to kind of my experience with DH many years ago or with editing, because I think it's also related, or it also kind of shows up some of the virtues of the Casebook project. So I think one of the great things about the way that Lauren has presented the seven questions is that she's demonstrating what I think of as the kind of humility of the editorial process. I worked on a project that published the papers of Thomas Edison across different media, including digital media. And it was something that came up again and again and again that we had to constantly correct for. And that was, particularly one of these extended projects, you're constantly sort of learning what your questions are. But the thing you have to keep unlearning is the questions you are creating your project to answer. Because you don't know, right, what researchers in the future are going to ask of the resources that you're helping to produce. So there's this kind of fundamental humility there that takes a kind of constant correction, at the same time a kind of admitting a certain prestige, if you like, to the evidentiary engagement. So just two quick examples from the Edison work that I did to underscore this point. We had no idea what people were going to wander in the door asking, and we had set up this whole environment. It was a mountain of materials, organized, as you can imagine, since it was the papers of Thomas Edison, around a series of inventions, tabletop technologies, experimental notebooks. I mean, they were real prestigious, I mean, things that struck us as the kind of key orienting features. And then people would wander in, you know, some physicists wandered in at one point, wondering whether in his work on the carbon lamp filament or carbon resistors, if Edison had happened upon, without realizing it, buckyballs, these specialized, slippery, giant carbon atoms that are shaped like Buckminster Fuller, shapes. There was no way we could answer that. There was no way we could think about the ways our resources could answer that. Another time, somebody wandered in, you know, to Edison, the motion pictures and all the rest. They wanted to know about early cinematic representations of these particular rope tricks that people were doing on some of these earlier. I mean, there's just no way that we could ever. Anyway, so there was that kind of lesson. And then sort of second to this, and this is kind of more apropos, the project had developed an elaborate coding scheme for the subjects of documents. So this was part of our, you know, kind of rigorous imposition of metadata behind the scenes. And we just had extraordinary fights, like loud screaming in the office fights, very ugly, about making this metadata public. I see Lauren and her team kind of working with this too. I mean, they're letting it out, right? But thinking at the same time, I mean, we heard about labels, sure. We heard about topics, sure. And then we saw that great handmade index, right? Our subject fields were the handmade index. It's the richest, most wonderful access to, in a sense, a kind of granular interpretation of the records you're working with. And it's really kind of only by balancing all of those different things that I think one ultimately arrives at, if you're, you know, kind of alert, I think, at a new humility about what you're doing. Anyway, so those are just a kind of few things, present and past, that I wanted to get to. And I guess the last thing I wanted to sort of finish up with, just maybe to turn the conversation back to Lauren for a minute, and think about the content, if you will, the way she's described it, of these cases, which is so striking, particularly to those of us who aren't specialists in this material. We have here the way she's described it, and I had a teeny bit more detail on paper than she was able to convey in her brief remarks, a matrix of knowledges, I'd call it, right? So little knowledge practices. One you heard about most prominently was horary astrology, astrology or a form of divination that's based crucially on the moment a question is asked. Kind of, it's more important than the question itself, you might even say, the moment it's asked. So there's that form of astrology. One of the principals, Napier or Forman, I can't remember which, also engaged in geomancy, which is another form of divination. These are ancient divination practices. But Lauren also mentions uroscopy, which is basically seeing what a person's health is by looking at their urine. And she comments in the materials that I read that uroscopy was sort of falling into disfavor. So at the same moment, we have these divination practices that seem to be, in a sense, almost unquestioned in the materials that we saw. Uroscopy is falling, you know, is a knowledge practice in decline. But we know, too, that these practitioners were also religious. So there were certain religious beliefs and practices, religious experiences that are documented in these casebooks. So those are at least four countervailing, four different knowledge practices to which we'd have to add the cardinal knowledge practice of writing. And each of these, I mean, I think Cliff and Matt were gesturing in this direction. Knowledge practices are dynamic. You don't have to think about digitization to realize this. But each of these is a moving target that Lauren and her colleagues are able to see across a 40-year time span, right? They have to be seen into the present day, too. And so the question, I suppose, of my provocation is to think about all, for Lauren, is to think about these as a kind of complex, but then also to ask about symmetry, how it is you can appreciate these various knowledge practices that are or are not contradictory with one another without imposing judgments from the day. I mean, when you say magic and medicine, what about when medicine was magic? How do you sort of keep at bay the kind of thorough imposition of the diagnostic codes of the present day?
And we have some time now for questions. Perhaps I'll ask the first question just as a bridge while you gather your thoughts. But I'm interested, Lauren, in the idea of search, which you talked a little bit about. We haven't talked about so much in the follow-up. And this is partly just a sort of paradox that I encounter a lot in my own work with a large digital archive and trying to construct it and think about what I'm doing when I'm constructing it. And that's that when we search, and most people who come to a very large corpus of manuscript material are going to engage with it through search. Very few people are going to start at the beginning, read it through. Most people are coming to it through some kind of search form. But what we're searching is not the manuscript. We're searching the metadata. We're searching the things that the team have chosen and not chosen to mark up, to tag, to encode in various ways. And there's this sort of weird sense in which we are coming to these projects to engage with the primary materials. But when we come to them through search, we're actually engaging with an interpretative layer that reflects the concerns, and the priorities and the sort of the sense of what does the project team think people want to come to this corpus for. And so this is this sort of apparent transparency of the digital archive, its apparent objectivity. Search, we believe, gives us back something that is, it comes from a machine, it must be objective. There's no subjectivity involved. In fact, there's this incredible number of hours of incredible work behind all of this from the project team, who have made all of these decisions about what they're going to mark up, what they're not going to mark up, how they're going to make this material present itself, what they're going to allow you to see and what they're not going to allow you to see, in other words. So I'm kind of curious to hear more about that process and your experience with that process and the decisions you made and the principles behind it.
The first thing I want to say is thank you to, is this one on? To the commentators, because I already have huge amounts to think about. So the answer about search, I mean, everybody's talking about the same thing here. It's like, I'm delighted that everybody likes the project, but in terms of the questions, what we're doing when we create this new archive, this was my starting point, but it's what we keep coming back to. You're creating something new out of something old, and how do you manage the expectations and the access to it? And that's what I think your question about search is about. So there are a variety of different ways that I can answer this. I could tell you a Just So story about how Forman, whose system it is, was extremely systematic, and he was our model. And we set out working chronologically, and Forman taught Napier, and Forman's records only 5.5 years survived. They're more fragmented. Napier's full run for 40 years, more or less, survived. Napier went off on his own and became very, very slovenly and broke the system. And there we were stuck with the system. And right now we are trying to get ourselves out of this area we've backed ourselves into. There were 5 topics when we began, and now we have around 500. And that was never the plan. So, but the less Just So story version of an answer is that what we have discovered is that although there is this tension, some people want to know, and it helps to situate a case to know, to have percentages about gender or age, the kind of the data stuff, or even how many women are asking, are they pregnant, or asking about lost dogs. That kind of material is, the data is useful for that. But what most people need, and I've talked with other projects that also have realized that, is nobody needs 80,000 cases. What most people need is the right 5, or maybe the right 50, or the right 500. And the illusion that you referred to, that you can just give people the data, and if you code it right, they'll be able to navigate it and find it, it is just an illusion. And as we move, as we redo the site and move to the Cambridge Digital Library, the plan is to curate much more and possibly even hide the topic so they're not menus, but people can put in whatever words they want, and we will then prompt and say, you know, you thought you wanted this, but actually, this is what you're going to want. So that we get people to their 5 or 50 or 500 cases, and they don't go away saying, I put in diabetes, and there's no diabetes, because there is no diabetes in this period, right? You know, it's not. But there is, for a historian of diabetes, there is some stuff there. They just need us to help them find it. And that takes me back to that illusion of completeness and access. What we're totally missing here is the respect for the archivists, the librarians, or the data wranglers. And the idea that you just do this, you go in with your little search box and you find it all by yourself, is not the way the world has ever worked, and it's not the way it's going to work now. And that's partly why I like that we've come back to the homemade index, because that's an old tool that is made by people for people.
Thank you. We have quite a few questions.
questions in the audience, I want to give everybody here a chance to put their thoughts to Lauren.
I found myself thinking all the way through about the most unusual part of the record, which is the chart. And I think Lisa's conclusion actually gave me purchase on what I wanted to ask, which is to describe the, I think you said four different kinds of knowledge. Is that how you, or four different shapes of knowledge, yeah, anatomized. And I was just wondering if there's, it seemed to me from your summary that part of the records fell out. Or that it was, perhaps I didn't understand your summary of it, but is there a way to digitize that and summarize that meaningfully? And is the project doing that?
The short answer is no, we're not doing it. And it's partly because it's very complicated. It's not just complicated because you need your astrology there. Lots and lots of people who have very, very good astrology, and astrologers love computational tools, so you can get a historical computational tool. But our astrologers are not as good as the computers. Our astrologers make mistakes. And so the problem that you end up with is we can generate charts for the times at which the questions are asked. And we can check the astrologer's charts against that very heavy editing. And we do this sometimes when we need to find out something about a case that we think is embedded in the chart and nowhere else. We'll read them and sort it out. So we are, was it Cliff? Somebody talked about, you know, where the silences are, where the gaps are. This is one of the things where what we're doing is setting it up so that people who want to study the astrology in there can, but we don't think it needs, we're doing enough with it without trying, even if we had the resources, to edit and code all of the information in there. And it's been very interesting. I have two little stories that I will tell you. One is that at the beginning of this phase of the project, I assembled 30 academics and actually some non-academics from all different disciplines, and they decided to tell us what the project needed to do better. We basically said, here, give us presentations on the project, and great things came out. But a number of them decided that the answer to what was wrong with the people and was in the charts. And it was, they thought that if we could just go and read every single chart, we would have, as it were, demographic data. And I never expected this to happen. So they were treating the astrological charts like the results of blood tests. It was a fascinating move, because it's the science bit, right? And the other thing that's happening is that some computer game developers came to us and wanted to make a game, and we are working as consultants for them. That seems to keep the relationship healthy. But they are using, so in the game, you, I think, if I've understood it, you get to be the astrologer, and they are using this astrological software so that the time matters, and you play your way through with the chart incorporated. And what I like about this is that actually, if they do it right, that will give you a feel for that kind of knowledge better than we could do by capturing it in coded form in each of the instances, right? It's demonstrating its value rather than trying to give it this particular importance in the chart. That begins to answer.
Thanks. I wanted to follow up on that, actually, because something that really struck me during your talk tonight and in some of your work that I've been reading recently about the casebooks is the experiential nature of the patient involved and having the casebook sort of written up in front of the patient and having the patient participate in the chart. And I'm curious in your decisions on how to curate or how to encode this data, how you sort of thought about including that experientialness or the participation of the patient, because that seems to also be one of the silences in a way.
So I have a sort of working paper called Talking Cures in Early Modern England. You know, I keep playing with the notion of the encounter. And in retrospect, we should have coded all reported speech. We are now coding reported speech, right? Because what you can do is, goes back to the point about close reading. You can spend hours on a single case, if it's a rich enough case. They're not all rich enough. But establishing who is in the room or who is not in the room, because much of this is done by correspondence, and working out who said what, because and the value of what these different people said. So this is where all these different signs that Matthew was setting out come into play. And you see the astrologers, in particular cases, saying the chart says, the patient says, and I observe, in language that isn't quite that language. And what I would like to do is to actually start to bundle those cases so that people can make sense of that dynamic. And then there's an added feature, which is the retrospective comments. So then, in just some cases, the astrologers will add later notes saying, it proved, she proved with child, or whatever it is, right? But which gives you a sense of conversation and social dynamic beyond the consulting room. So a bunch of that we already tagged. We have, you know, one of the problems with the current very flat search form is that we have much, much more stuff than you can, even in all of those options you currently have, than you can find. So what we're trying to do is work out how, with the new interface, that richness can emerge. But also, if you're just interested in cases, if you want to find all the cases with follow-up information, right now we're not giving anybody that facility. And these demands are emerging as people come to us with questions, and also as we allow ourselves to work on these things. And, you know, I mean, I scream at the site all the time. I can't find anything, and I have to get in touch with an editor and say, where did we put that? And, you know, if I can't use it, then it's not working. It's open, and that's why it's open, is so that we can work these things out, and in 18 months' time, it'll all ostensibly be locked down so that in perpetuity, everyone can use it as they want to.
I was just, well, I have a different kind of question. I was wondering, because the years of the casebooks cover the years when new medicines and maybe new diseases were coming into England from all over the world. So I wondered if you see them experimenting, or I guess it would only be Napier, experimenting or incorporating novel cures from Africa or the Middle East or America into his medication?
Part of the answer to this is in the silences, that they had separate prescription books and payment books, which we don't have anymore. So there are some remedies written in. And as far as we can tell, we haven't, you know, we're waiting for the right PhD student to come along and actually work on the remedies. And they're, you know, they're horrible. Absolutely, you know, they're just horrible, ugly lists of things. We have some sense with them. Right now, what we're doing is we code when there is a recipe there, but we're not going in. But then we have, for instance, there's a postdoc working on green sickness and diseases of virgins, and he is going through all the cases, and the remedies are crucial. Now, the kinds of remedies, I mean, basically it's all purgative stuff of various sorts. And occasionally they do note, you know, this you know, this is whatever, the eighth case of this kind of fever, and there must be something happening, but they don't ever say anything big like, you know, it arrived on such and such a boat. But we're trying to balance all of these different remedies with, there are very weird interventions with angels and forms of prayer that sit happily alongside all these other forms of purgation. Praying and using the angels is both a form of divining, but also of expelling the bad things from your body. So some of this is them actually innovating, using that, that's new for them. Why they're doing it, you know, is a whole other story. But we're not getting enough, I think, to situate them in a whole economy of new medicine, though it is something that is sort of on the wish list to look at properly in more detail.
I wanted to get back to the full text search question. I'm struck by how much effort you put into developing the vocabularies and the terms, and I can see another problem with full text search that besides the one you already alluded to, the spelling differences, or as Matthew mentioned, the diseases have different names today, so people might be looking for diabetes and it's not mentioned that way. Still. And then the fact that the size of the cases is fairly small, the amount of text, so a lot of the statistical methods that would work in other information retrieval systems might not help you a lot. But full text search is such low hanging fruit. I'm curious why you haven't pursued it further, considering how much work you put into the labeling and the faceting.
The briefest answer is that my technical director doesn't want to. But the real answer is that we were worried that we were just going to disappoint again and again and again. And that was with our current interface. With the move to the digital library, there will be one box. If I've understood the way this is going to work, there will be what looks like free text search, and we will enable it as much as we can. So you will put your word or your phrase into that box, and we will do as best we can to make sure that you get the results that are meaningful to you. And that will happen with faceted results, so that you will see not just, you know, the one item or the five items that are the ones that are most relevant, but that where you'll see where they're situated in the corpus and how they associate with other things. So we will do it. One of the questions that will make the mess of our topics and classifications at this corner we backed ourselves into, which will make it go away, which I'm currently negotiating with my editors, is for us to take something like 1,000 cases and edit every single word in them and make it so that those can be fully searched. So there'll be a mechanism which will involve normalization and standardization. My editorial team is absolutely fantastic, and they will not let me do anything quick and dirty. So I said, let's just modernize all the spelling and everything, and then people can put words in, and then at least they'll be able to find all the white things in the records. They said that goes against every principle that we have put in place here. So it's, you know, what I'm sharing with you is we have some negotiations within the project, the move to the digital library is an opportunity for us to sort that out and to just make it so that at least the illusion of a full text searching is there. I mean, it is always, as Marion was saying, it is always an illusion when you think you're doing full text searching. But you can get our stuff off of GitHub and search it, and you know, anyone can do that. The problem is that you don't know what you've found right? That the archive is really weird, right? And so we end up with just disappointed people. And this is where we, you know, when people write to us about the diabetes, we spend time and we give them what they need. But if we just gave them the ability to search the corpus, they would find nothing. And so I hear what you're saying, and the easy side of it is on the list of things that we will be doing.
This sounds like the perfect conversation to take out and continue over a glass of wine. So I'd really just like to thank Lauren once again for presenting just an incredible project, really an amazing piece of work there. And also to our three respondents who have engaged very interestingly and given us a lot of additional thought-provoking material. So thank you to all of our panelists, and please do join us outside for a glass of wine and some food and some more conversation.